You know, we just got through six sessions of conference. What lessons did you hear during conference that has applicability to this class? Yeah.
I thought about our talk on Saturday afternoon about goals.
Goals. Yeah. You know, what I liked about that is it was the difference between a goal and a plan.
Yeah.
So I'm thinking about rechanging my, not just goals, but goal planning or something like that. I thought that was awesome too. Other Andres.
I also talked about having the language with alcohol. I mean, this sounds like very
important
about that. So, I think the alcohol is like really strict to all the kind of things.
Having this as part of your family life, having the language of the gospel at home, because personal finance is just part of the gospel. Other ones? Other thoughts?
I felt like the overall theme of, for me at least, personally, it was about like the simple things of the gospel are what make life joyful and make life good. And so and the gospel can get complicated if you let it, just like finances and thinking about that, like, our finances, we can make it as complicated as we want, but really it's doing the small and the simple things in our finances and in our spiritual lives that make the biggest impact.
Okay. Small and simple things that will make the difference. And I thought it was just interesting. You guys remember the church auditing report? Normally you don't get much out of the church auditor's report. What was his last little paragraph? We reiterate the common themes of the church: to live within a budget, get and stay out of debt, and live within your means. But I thought it was neat as we listened that you can actually take things from our class from this framework. Let's talk a little bit about this section here for what we're going to work on today. So, section on estate planning, I'd like you to use 114. What's your current estate planning strategy? What estate planning strategy should you use as your assets grow? For most of you, this is going to be very short. Excuse me, I should have changed that, 5.49. It's going to be a short section, but I at least want you to kind of think through these issues, and we will get through a lot of those. Then the section on wills, it'll include your holographic will, and if you're married, you need the holographic will of your spouse as well. Again, follow teaching 201E. If you have an existing will, you can use that in the place of the holographic will. It should not be a fill-in-the-blank will. You'll also include Learning Tool 14, which is Utah Advanced Healthcare Directives. And you will include this. You'll fill it out and you'll include it as part of your will section. Okay. Make sense? One other thing, no office hours between 9:30 and 10:30 today. I'm taking my wife to the airport. It's spring break, so my wife and my daughter are going with another daughter and the grandkids to go back to Universal Studios, so they're having a fun time. I have to stay here and work. Let's see if there's anything else. Number two, we're sending that box around. That's everything that's been handed in and graded, so if you can take things out of that. Now, when's the investment plan due?
Today.
So after class, you want to hand those on in, I will take those. Okay. So I would like to start with I'm not a country fan, but I like this song. Some of you have heard it. I think it has relevance to what we're talking about today.
I like that song because it forces us.
What I'd like to do is I'd like to change that around, which is die like you live.
Last night, my wife and I, she's got a goal every day to hit 20,000 steps on her Fitbit. So we do a lot of walking. But as we were walking, we were talking about having Blake here today and talking about trust and how do you set it up so when you pass away that you still can be an influence to your children and your grandchildren. You know, it's not that we take care of our families until we die. We should be taking care of our families after that as well. And so it brought up an interesting discussion. We talked about missions and education and what we're trying to do. When my before my dad passed away, my mom died at 53. I was 17 years old, almost 18. And then my dad remarried, and so we have a blended family. So it just causes some interesting things. And before my dad passed away, he put together a trust where there are certain assets that the family had before he remarried and certain assets afterwards. And because of what that happened, and he also went through and he sat down with each of the children and said, okay, this is what's going to happen when I pass away. We're putting this into the trust, and this is what you will get, and this is what we're distributing. And so it was an interesting thing. When my dad passed away, there was no questions, there was no arguing, there was no fighting over which asset goes to which. And the assets were large. But it was an easy transition. So what I'd like to do is, I ask, like many other things in life, when it gets, it's a really difficult subject, what do? You bring in the experts. So let me just tell a little bit about Blake. Blake was actually in this class. And when Clarilyn Hill and her husband, they served as mission presidents, I didn't know who was going to teach. Blake goes, you know what, my dad is an estate planning lawyer in St. George. I bet he would do an awesome job. So I immediately got on the phone, and his dad said, sure, I'd love to. And I think his dad, you know, realized that Blake had volunteered it, so about 2 years ago or something like that, 33. His dad said, Blake, you're the one who got me into this. I think I'm going to have you start coming down. So Blake's coming down ever since. So we're very appreciative to have Blake here. I'll let him give a little bit more. Realize there's two sets of PowerPoints today. Mine is more detailed that will help you with the quiz. His is probably more informative and help you with life, but you'll need to review both sections. And so, can I have a big hand for Blake Johnson?
Thing
you got it. Okay. So we'll go till about 10 after.
Okay. All right. Well, thank you for having me. It's always good to come back to BYU and reminisce.
Blake got even. He's the one who got me. I had to go speak in Las Vegas.
Yeah. That was me. I pulled him out of class because I figured he was due for all the times that we've come up here. So. So I went to, after BYU, I went to law school at LSU. A little bit of background on me. So I have no idea who I'm going to cheer for when BYU plays LSU for their opener this fall, but I will be at the game. I live in Las Vegas. That's where I currently practice. Do estate planning, anything under that, you know, envelope of different practice areas within the law. Married, I've got two kids, and it's good to be back. So estate planning is a very wide subject, but today we're going to talk about the basics. So benefits, well, you guys know a little bit about that already. Financial security for loved ones. As Professor Sudweeks talked about, it definitely simplifies the administration process. You can protect your estate. You can control from the grave, reduce or eliminate estate taxes, and encourage or educate younger beneficiaries. So what happens if you die without a will or trust? You have nothing in place. What happens if you die tomorrow? Well, your stuff, your assets, everything you have goes will have to go through probate if the total value is more than $100,000 in Utah, or if you live in Nevada, like me, it's $25,000, so really small amount. Yeah.
Is it only if we're not residents in the state of Utah, it'll still apply?
It's wherever the state that you're a resident of. So each state has a different exemption amount before you have to do probate. Most of them are around that 100,000 mark. California is 150, Arizona is about 100. Nevada is just the lowest in the country for some reason. Which is ironic because it's the best state in the country for a trust law. So just for, I guess they want to force you to do your estate planning. So probate is just this fancy word for court proceedings to distribute your assets. General rule of thumb is you're going to lose about 5% of your estate value to attorney's fees and court costs, and it's going to tie those assets up for a minimum of 6 months, usually closer to a year and a half to a couple years, depending on the size of the assets and the type. It's you know, if you have over 5.49 million, you're going to pay estate taxes on that, and it's a hefty tax. It's 40% of everything over that amount. And if you have a will, all that does is that changes now you decide who gets your stuff and instead of letting the state decide. And if no will, you go by the state's intestacy laws. So in Utah, if you have a separate property, then it goes, well, Utah is a separate property state as opposed to Nevada, which is a community property state. What that means is if you have assets from your marriage in Nevada, it's assumed any asset that you have when you died and if you're married, it's assumed that it's part of the community property, meaning that it's your spouse is the one who is also an owner in that. Whereas in Utah, it's assumed that it's separate property and you have to prove that it was part of the marital property. So that's just two differences in the laws. So Utah is separate property. So if you die, your separate property is if you're married and you have a surviving spouse and no children, it all goes to your spouse. If you have all children of that marriage, it also all goes to that spouse. And here's where it gets complicated. If you have children from a different marriage, you know, say you had a house that you bought while you were married and you had kids from a prior marriage, well, your wife now owns that house 50% with your kids from your previous marriage. All right, you can start to see where estate planning can come into play. If you are not married and you have kids, it goes to your kids. If no kids, then it goes up to your next living relative. So we go parents first, then siblings, nieces and nephews, grandparents, aunts and uncles, and so on, cousins down the road. If we cannot find anyone, then you are contributing to the state education fund. So thank you for that. So what's the purpose of a will? Couple of reasons. You want to name who's going to be in charge of your estate instead of letting, you know, the courts decide that. Same thing with guardian for minor children. You know, you want to decide that instead of letting the state decide that. It definitely simplifies the probate process because now we know what your intentions were, what you wanted to have happen. And you can create a trust within the will for minor kids because if they're not 18, then it has to go into a trust for them until they turn 18. So requirements to write a will, you must be 18. You must have a sound mind. No undue influence, that means no one's holding a gun to your head saying, put me in your will, and then properly executed and properly witnessed. So, you know, you have two witnesses and a notary in Utah. In Nevada, we just have to have two witnesses. So holographic will, interesting concept. I think most states do still honor these. It's all in your handwriting. It must be dated at the top, and it must be signed by you, and it's considered a valid will. In just a random fact, in Louisiana, they call it an holographic will, just because in Louisiana, they like to have everything different because they're Napoleonic code. So fun fact for the day. So what you want to do with yours is you're going to name your personal representative. If you have kids, name who's going to be the guardian of your children. You don't have to have any witnesses. And this is only applies if you do not have a complicated estate, which in my opinion means if you own real property, you need a real will. And even then, we'll get to it, you need a trust. But if you're a student, don't have really any assets, you maybe have a car or some bank accounts, that stuff, this is sufficient. All right, so here's an example for you that you can use when you're writing yours. So in your own handwriting, remember, write everything out. You can't type it out and then sign it at the bottom. It has to be completely in your own handwriting. So you say, I, Blake Johnson, being over 18 years of age, of sound mind, and not acting under duress, declare this to be my last will and testament, revoking all prior wills and codicils. A codicil is just an amendment to the will. I am married. My wife's name is Carly Johnson. We have the following children who are issue of our marriage, Brody and Blaine Johnson. I intend to dispose of all my property at the time of my death through this will. I give my car to my nephew, so on. The rest of my estate I give to my wife. If she does not survive me, I give the residue of my estate to my children. And I have intentionally omitted any existing heirs who are not specifically mentioned here. Any who shall contest this will shall receive only $1. they just put a dollar because then they get something, and it's just a court history thing. It really, you don't have to leave them anything. But that's a pretty common clause in just about every will and trust that I've ever seen. It's just one of those things where someone did it once, it worked, and so everybody started doing it, and it just hasn't gone away. The no contest part of it is a good part to have in there to say, you know, if anyone challenges this, no, I intentionally omitted those people. But the part about the dollar is just, you know, a funny part. If any part of this will is invalid, such invalidity shall not affect any other provision. My estate shall be administered by one personal representative. I nominate the following to serve as personal representative to administer my estate and to serve without bond, meaning that they don't have to go and get an insurance bond. In the order listed, you know, my dad, my brother, so on. My personal representative is authorized to do whatever is necessary to administer my estate. If my spouse does not survive me, I nominate the following in the order listed to act as guardians and conservators of, for my minor children. In witness whereof, I voluntarily sign my name this third day of April, should be 2017. Sign the document at the bottom and keep it in a place where people can find it, because your will does no good if we cannot find it. Sometimes we can use a copy, but courts prefer the original. So it needs to be safe, but it needs to be found.
If for some reason all your personal representatives can't do it, or they
choose not to, will your estate automatically come to probate?
So if you're in will, you're in probate regardless?
Oh, yeah, sorry.
But yeah, so that's why it says list like two or three people. You want to have backups just in case someone can't do it. Yeah.
Is there a recommended for
an executor? Like, would you have your friend do it, or would you have someone like a business associate that you know that has no like interest in your will? Like, is there any kind of like guidelines for that?
There's no guidelines. From my experience, don't have your kids do it. That's when the most fights happen is, you know, the oldest sibling is named as the executor and the other kids are like, well, I don't want it done that way and so on. So someone outside of that is usually good. You know, if your parents are still in good health, you know, they're a good one to put. Having a third party is not a bad idea because, yeah, they're not interested in it. Obviously you want them to have enough interest that they'll take care of and do it properly and that you trust them with the money. That's a good question. Thanks. All right, and then, yeah, have your spouse do the same. And with the guardian for minor children, make sure you and your spouse have the same person listed and that you agree on that. Because if you die first and then your spouse dies, whatever your spouse said is what's going to happen to your kids. So if they have someone different, that's who they're going to go to. If you don't agree with that, you need to, you know, have that discussion. All right, so my next question is, a will really that much better than just going to probate with intestate laws? Because 90% of the time, if you're married, you want it all to go to your spouse, and that's what intestate laws say is going to happen, right? Well, I would argue that it's not, because all a will does, it changes who the beneficiaries are. You decide instead of letting the state decide. And the biggest reason you do a will is to name guardian of your minor children. That is the main reason you do it, because that doesn't happen in a trust. But other than that, a will is not really that much better than going through probate, because it's still going to take that minimum, I put 4 months, it's really 6 months, because you have to do a 90-day notice to creditors, and by the time you get court dates, because they only give them to you 3 weeks out and so on, it's going to be 6 months. And that's if everything goes right. And you have to get a court approval for all aspects of the estate. So if you own a business and you die and it's in probate and you have a partner, well, guess what? They have to go to the court to get approval for major business decisions. That's not a fun process. It takes a long time. It can put you out of business to be in that situation. So the answer is, there's a couple ways you can avoid probate. Joint tenancy, joint tenants on an account, on a house, anything like that. Naming a beneficiary, so life insurance, retirement accounts, those kind of things, or a POD, bank account.
You know what POD is.
Yeah, pay on death. Pay on death accounts. And the last one is holding assets in a trust. So we'll go through all these and why they may work, why they may not work. So here's the problems with joint tenancy. Your interest can be attached to another joint tenant's liabilities. So you go buy a house, or your parents buy a house, they put you on there as the joint tenant with them. So if they die, the house goes to your name. Well, you get in a car wreck and get sued, they can come after your parents' house, because you're a joint tenant. Anything that you own is now subject to that lawsuit. It circumvents a will or trust provisions, and it can disinherit kids. So once again, if they put your name on it, you don't have to give it to your siblings, you know, share it to your siblings, even though that's what your parents wanted. It only postpones probate until the second joint tenant dies, or if you die together, we have a double probate, so even more cost and time. There's gift tax consequences, capital gain for income tax if they sell it. If there's incompetency, that's another nightmare. And joint tenants with a non-spouse means loss of control. So let's give an example. So dad buys a house for $50,000. He adds his son on as a joint tenant in 2006, and then in 2011, he decides to sell the house. So dad's basis in the house is only $50,000, so they have $100,000 in gain, and that's gonna be split equally among son and dad. Okay, even though son doesn't probably get any of that money because it's all going to dad's bank account. So if it was the second option, dad dies, the house is worth $150,000. Son gets the house with dad's interest stepped up, so only half of it is stepped up. So he still owes, if he sold it, he would still have $50,000 in taxable income. So if we do a trust, there's a couple of the benefits. There's no probate. If you set it up properly and you fund it properly, way less time, 2 weeks versus those 6 months. Ease of transfer, way less money to spend. You have more control, privacy, protection, flexibility, all those things, and we'll get into that in more detail. But here, and back to that same example, if we put it in a trust, so dad still buys that house. In 2006, instead of his naming his son as a joint tenant, he puts it into his trust. Then when dad sells the house, there's no tax consequences for the son. It's just the dad has the $100,000 in taxable income because that's his basis was $50,000. But if dad dies, son gets the house without it going through probate, and he gets 100% stepped up basis because that's what he had no interest in it before. So now if he sells the house, he pays zero tax instead of tax on $50,000. So a much better solution, still the same outcome that the dad wanted, that it all goes to the son. So a lot better situation. Everyone clear on that? That makes sense? All right, so what is a trust? It's similar to a legal entity. It can own property. It does not die. So the idea is when we set up a trust, we transfer all of your assets into it, and then that way there's nothing in your name, so there's nothing to probate when you die. So there's three different people with the trust. There is the trustor, that's the person who set up the trust. There's the trustee, the person who manages the assets of the trust, and then there's the beneficiary. And when you set up a living trust, which means that it's revocable, you can change it, you can alter it whenever you want as long as you're alive, you are all three. You are the trustor, the trustee, and the beneficiary. And then you designate who the backup trustee is if you die or are incompetent, and who the beneficiaries are when you pass. But you never give up that trustor position. The trust must be a written agreement. It has to be actually typed out, signed. And notarized. Once you die, with the transition with the trust is very simple. I get a copy of the death certificate. I prepare what's called an affidavit of successor trustee. The successor trustee signs that. They take that to the bank. We record it with the county. They are now on all of the assets for the trust. Usually about 2 weeks because it takes 10 days to get a death certificate. So compare that to probate. Much quicker time. You're not losing 5% of the estate value. You're paying me $100 or something like that. Very simple process.
And you'll probably talk about this. And the other thing about probate is a public record.
Yes.
So you can go down and you can go through the court records and see all the probate, what went where, which assets went to which person, and all of these things.
Yep. There's a lot of famous people that have died that you can go look up their stuff. Whitney Houston was a big one. So you know exactly where her money went. The newest one is Prince. It's been, everyone's coming out of the woodwork saying that they had a kid with Prince. So that's making that estate really complicated. He did not even have a will. So it's going to be a mess. His estate's worth over $850 million. He's paying a lot. That the state is paying a lot of estate taxes. But yes, it becomes public record, and you can go look up anyone's. You just pay the $5 fee to get a copy of it. It's usually what it is. Okay. What else does a trust do? Well, you can control who gets what, when, and under what conditions. I've had clients say that their kids only get it if they're married to a Jewish person, if the kids go to college. I had one that they're not getting anything until they turn 65 and show that they worked for 30 years. That's their retirement plan. So you can do whatever you want with the trust, pretty much.
In fact, my wife, like I said, when we're talking about this trust that help with our kids, you know, what are the things that we value? We value the gospel, we value missions, we value education. And we just realize that it's going to be hard for our kids and our grandkids really going to school. And so if we can kind of put something to help out with, you know, wouldn't pay the whole cost, but could help out with some missions and educations, that would at least let them know what grandma and grandpa, you know, thought was important. So it's kind of, you know, it's an interesting conversation
it
to
is.
Have about, you know, how do you want to help your children once you pass away?
And the problem that he's filing it out is he told me is, he and his wife didn't have what they thought was the same vision. They're talking about it and they're realizing, oh, wait, we got to talk this out and make sure that we're on the same page here. So it's a good way to make sure that you and your spouse are on the same page there. A living trust is never recorded. So that's that next point we talked about. Only if there's a dispute over the trust. So if the trustee is not doing a good job, so the beneficiary sue that person because they're not doing their fiduciary duty, then it becomes public record, but until that point, you know, the assets generally are not put in there. It's just a copy of the trust. And then lastly, a living trust does not give you liability protection. That's a big misconception. Trusts can give you liability protection, but you have to do an irrevocable trust, which means you cannot change it once it's set up. You have to give up control. A living trust is a disregarded entity as far as the IRS is concerned, so it's everything's flow through to you. It's not going to change your tax status or anything like that. So a trust, like I said, it's an empty box, and we fund it by putting all your assets in there. So you put your boat, your money, stocks, your house, and that's what constitutes your trust. If you do not fund it, you know, assign your interest to it, put the trust name on the bank account, it is not in your trust, and those assets will go through probate.
So can a husband and wife make a joint trust?
Yes. Yep. And that's the most common one that I do is a joint trust. And if you ever do get divorced, the court order for the divorce automatically nulls that trust.
So how do you go about setting up a living trust?
Go to an estate planning attorney. Do not go to the online ones. I've seen those forms, and generally what I do is if I get a client that comes in and says, hey, you know, we set this up online, can you just review it? So I say, okay. What did you think you were putting in your trust? What did you want it to say? And I write it all down so that, you know, we have it on record. And then I go through and I say, okay, here's what your trust actually says. And 95% of the times, those two things do not match. Because what you're doing is you're filling out a form, you're not getting legal advice, and you're not having the document, you know, made to what your wishes are. You know, and half the time, they're not state specific, so they don't have certain clauses that each state wants in there.
Generally, when it comes to really detailed things, you know, insurance, estate planning, wills, things like that. Notice I bring in an expert. That's what I would recommend you to do on most of this stuff. I mean, especially in the legal side. You don't want to make a mistake because you weren't willing to pay the extra bucks. I'd pay a little bit extra to make sure that I was comfortable with it.
Yeah.
Then I'd have it reviewed by a couple of places too. So, you know, just to make sure that you're covered.
Yeah, and most estate planning attorneys will do a, you know, free consultation to where they can review your documents or anything like that. And make sure you go to an estate planning attorney, not like, you know, a litigation attorney or, you know, a criminal attorney, because those, yeah, they may be able to do it, but they don't have the experience to know, you know, all the ins and outs of it, just like I would not practice criminal law.
So I don't have any kids, and my wife mm-hmm. and I don't own that much.
Mm-hmm.
So right now I feel like I have no reason to go do this. Do you have like a rule of thumb or benchmark that, like, when you hit this certain net worth or when you have kids or something like that, that we should go to an attorney and set this up?
Generally, my recommendation is if you own a house, if you own any real property, that's when you want to go and worry about a trust. Because prior to that, most of the stuff, you know, it's a beneficiary account, life insurance or whatever, you can designate, you know, your spouse and then your kids. You know, in the vehicles, it's under that 100,000 mark, so we don't have to worry about it. So those at that point, you know, we don't have to do probates, so that doesn't matter. Once you own a house, it doesn't matter what the value is, you have to do probate in most states. So that's usually when I recommend you go and start talking about it. All right, so here's some reasons to use a trust. You want to control distributions to minors, so you don't want them to get a big chunk as soon as they turn 18. So this may, you know, maybe you don't have own a house yet, but you have a substantial life insurance policy, or you're starting to build up a substantial you know, IRA, 401k, something like that, and you don't want the kids to get that as soon as they turn 18. That might be another step to come and talk about a trust, because now you say, well, it needs to be used for education first, or they don't get it till they turn 25, you know, whatever you want to do there. My general recommendation is don't, you know, spread it out minimum of three different lump sums so that they have three chances to blow it. And then what I found is if they haven't figured it out by 35, they're never going to figure it out. So if you don't trust your kids, just give them a monthly amount. They get all the income from it on a monthly basis, yearly basis, whatever. But you can control that from the trust.
And I found I've extended family, the quote is trust babies.
Yes.
And it has not been a blessing in their lives.
No.
So just some insight.
Yep.
It's probably a foolish question, but I'm having a hard time seeing how a trust and a will work together.
Mm-hmm.
Does the will outline what the trust does, or are they separate documents?
Yes, they are separate documents. So the will is a document that's only valid upon your death. So it doesn't come into play until you die. And the trust is a living trust, so you want to transfer your assets while you're living. If you do everything properly and transfer it into the trust, and there's nothing outside of your trust when you die, there's no need for a will because everything's governed by the trust. What we do is we also prepare, when we do a trust, we do prepare what's called a pour-over will. All that says is if for some reason we forgot to put something in the trust, everything goes into the trust upon our death. We have to go through probate at that point, but it's kind of our catch-all provision. So that's the relationship there. That's a good question to clarify. Really good reason to have a trust is if you have special needs children. You don't want them to be disqualified from government assistance upon your death. And so what we do is we set up a special needs trust that says that they are the beneficiary of it, but the trustee pays directly for all their needs, and so they never are disqualified from government assistance in those situations. So, you know, that's a very good use of a trust as well.
That's what Fred was talking about with his daughter, his special needs daughter.
Mm-hmm.
Fred Hawkins asked.
Okay, so let's go. Last one I really like to use trust is we can reduce state taxes. This is one of my favorite quotes. This is Judge Learned Hand. He was a justice for the New York Supreme Court, but he's probably the most quoted judge in history. The U.S. Supreme Court quotes him all the time. So he said, over and over again, courts have said that there is nothing so sinister and so in arranging one's affairs as to keep taxes as low as possible. Everybody does so, rich and poor, and all do right, for nobody owes any public duty to pay more than the law demands. Taxes are enforced exactions, not voluntary contributions. So let's talk about taxes. Talk about gift tax first. So right now there's a unified gift and estate tax in the federal government. Basically says you have $5.49 million. You can either give that away while you're living through a gift, or you can give it away upon your death through your trust or a will or whatever you want to do. Anything you have under that amount, you pay no tax on. Anything over that $5.49 million, you're going to pay a 40% tax on. So the exclusion to that is each year you can give away up to $14,000 per person per year without having to file a gift tax return. Anything over $14,000, you have to file the gift tax return and you start depleting that exemption amount. Yes, so there are other exclusions. Education and medical costs are ones if you pay it directly to the school or to the provider. Those ones are excluded from that $14,000. So, great question. And it's $14,000 per person. So, if you are married, you and your spouse can give $14,000 each to that one child. So, that's $28,000 you can give to them. and then 28,000 to the next kid, and 28,000 to the next kid, or anyone in the world. It's not limited to family. So if you make a lot of money, you're trying to get rid of your estate for tax purposes, Professor Sudweeks and I are always open to donations. So you're free to give it to us. All right. So, yes.
What are the rules, like what is considered a gift?
So is it just monetary gifts, or if I take my kids on a big trip, does that count?
Technically, yes. As your attorney, I would say you should count that. but, you know, it's got to be trackable. Usually it's, you know, if there's a transaction involved, you know, recording of a property, you know, a big transaction, those kind of things, taking them on a trip, generally you're not going to get in trouble for. It's usually when there's a recorded transaction. All right, so just a brief history lesson for you with what the exemptions amount used to be. 2003, it was as low as $1 million. So my dad was doing a lot of more estate tax planning back then, and it went up slowly. And then 2010 was the year to die, because there was no estate tax. There were still gift taxes, but there was no estate tax.
They call that the year to push grandpa out of the wheelchair.
Yes, that was the year George Steinbrenner died, owner of the Yankees. They paid no estate tax on his estate. So that was a great year for them. The reason that happened is when President Bush came in to the presidency, he wanted to eliminate estate taxes altogether. And so that's when it first started tearing up, because before that it was at $1 million for a long time. And so they had scheduled it to go up and up and up and eventually to phase out. And the idea was that hopefully it would not be renewed. But the problem they ran into is the federal government gets about $40 billion a year from estate taxes. They didn't have a way to make up that money. And so that's when it was reintroduced in 2011 at $5 million, and it's been indexed for inflation ever since. And so that's why each year it goes up, you know, little by little. So this year we're up to $5.49 million. So what would taxes be if you had a $10 million estate in each of those years? You can see the numbers on that. I don't know who this said this, but estate taxes are not really taxes, but penalties imposed on those who neglect to plan ahead or who retain unskilled estate planning attorneys. So just a plug that estate taxes can be avoided pretty much altogether, especially if you're charitably inclined. So another example, in 2017, person A dies with a taxable estate of $5.45 million. Well, it should be 5.49. Forgot to update that one. He has already given that much in gifts. So that amount that he has gift is added back into his estate, so he's back up to, so basically you double his estate, he's up to $10,980,000. Whether you do the gift during your lifetime or not, he's basically still gonna have $5.49 million to pay taxes on, so at that 40%, you're at $2.196 million that is paid in taxes. Now, if you have husband and wife, and we plan correctly, we can avoid that. But let's just show you another in the example how it would work if you didn't do it properly. You just did a general trust and you left everything to your spouse. So the estate's worth $11 million. Husband dies in 2017 and everything goes to the wife. There's no estate taxes there because there's an exemption that says if you give everything to your spouse, you don't pay estate tax on that because they know they'll get it when the spouse dies. So 1 month later, wife dies. She's only spent $20,000, and same amount as that last example, $10,980,000, taxes of $2.196 million. Okay? Now, if we set this up correctly through the trust, we do what's called an AB split, which basically says that upon the death of the first to die, we're going to split the trust in two. We're going to take the complete exemption amount from the person who died, and we're going to set up that up in an exemption trust. And then the rest goes to the survivor's trust. And by doing that, we capitalize on that person's exemption. So we already take $5.49 million out. That becomes its own entity. It has its own tax ID, files a tax return, all of that. And then survivor's trust, they can change and do whatever they want. That's still their living trust. But by doing that, if wife spends that $20,000 and dies a month later, there's exactly $5.49 million in each trust. There is zero taxes due because there's zero taxable estate at that point. So we just saved that family $2.196 million by adding four paragraphs into a trust. Okay? That's where having an experienced estate planning attorney comes in, because if someone else just did it the first way, they thought, oh, I did it in trust, I did it right, well, you just lost out on $2.1 million, or almost $2.2 million. So it can be very costly.
So is there anything from stopping people from making it just a bunch of trusts that are right at that limit of $5.49 million? And so they...
Well, you're only allowed to have one trust, or one exemption amount of $5.49 million. You can put it in 15 trusts, but your total estate's only going to be that $5.49 million. Yeah. But there is a way to do that. If you're living and we start gifting that $14,000 into a trust for your kid's benefit, and that's irrevocable, meaning we can't change it. That does get out of your estate, and no matter how much that grows, that is not considered part of your estate. Now, there's qualifications there. You have to do what's called a crummy letter. That was the attorney who first tried the case and won. So everyone calls them crummy letters, that says you have to give the children an opportunity to withdraw that money. They have 30 days to withdraw that money. Now you tell your kids, look, I don't withdraw this money, because if you do, I won't be putting into the trust again, and you'll get cut off and those kind of things. And look, if I do this, you know, generally you'll buy a life insurance policy with that money to help pay estate taxes, and they're going to make off way better than if they took the money now. So it's just an education thing. That's one of the ways we can avoid estate taxes as well. So I've already talked about that. That's what an ILET is it's an irrevocable life insurance trust. That's what
one
I just basically
need to know for the quizzes. Again, if it's in an ILET, is it included as part of the estate? The fact that it's irrevocable says it's no longer included in the estate. If it's not in an ILET, it would be included. So just a hint for the quiz.
Yep. Charitable gifting. There's what's called a charitable remainder trust. There's a couple different variations of it, basically. If you have a lot of wealth and you need a deduction on your income taxes today, you can transfer this to this irrevocable charitable trust. It pays you income while you're living, and then upon your death, it goes to the charity of your choosing that you designated. So really cool aspect there. GST is generation skipping tax. So say instead of going to your kids, it goes to the grandkids. There can be some taxes there if not set up properly. Valuation discounts or freezing appreciated assets, that gets into really complicated stuff that you guys don't need to know about. The Utah Domestic Asset Protection Trust is a cool one, though. Utah and Nevada are two of the only states in the country that have this. And basically what it says is you can put up to 50% of your assets into this trust. And if it's there for 2 years and you don't get sued, those assets are untouchable in future lawsuits. It's an irrevocable trust. There's some other qualifications, like you have to have a co-trustee who's not a spouse on there, so you give up control, but it can be very beneficial for you. Apparently I haven't gone over these slides in a while, because it's right in there next. That's basically covered all that. All right, so other parts of estate planning. What happens if someone becomes incapacitated and they can no longer function, they don't have the full mental capability, they don't have the full physical capability, they can't write checks anymore or anything like that. What happens in those instances? Well, we do advanced health care directive. That's one of the forms that you guys are required to put in your financial plan. The state of Utah gives you a form that says this is the one that we take, and so all the hospitals and healthcare places are familiar with them. Basically says who you want to make healthcare decisions for you if you're incapacitated. You want to put a backup in there. And then power of attorneys, there's many powers of attorneys. There's the two main ones, though, are a general power of attorney and then a springing power of attorney. A general power of attorney says that I give my wife the ability to sign my name whenever she wants from this day forward. Okay, that's not usually the ideal situation, because then she could go close all my accounts, take all the money, and leave, right? Or you have that for one of your kids. Your kids has that for you. Not usually the best situation, unless mom and dad are getting close to being in that incapacitated state. It's a lot better to have that. Our general recommendation for most people is a springing power of attorney. What that says is the power of attorney doesn't spring into effect until two doctors say that you are incapacitated. So make sure you have to have a medical qualification before they can sign on your behalf.
Can I make just a point here? Be very careful you give anyone a power of attorney, because that means they can do everything in your name.
I'm helping a daughter with some things right now, and so I have what's called a temporary power of attorney. I have a starting date, I have an ending date. The only purpose I have there is to helping her with this vehicle.
Yeah.
But so I would not do a power of attorney unless you really know what it is. And if you ever do something like that, a beginning date, an ending date, and a purpose.
Yeah, unless, like I said, that, you know, mom and dad, you can tell he's getting Alzheimer's, you're
yeah,
gonna need that.
Right.
That's a specific situation. But yeah, the limited power of attorney is far better. You know, I need it for selling this car or to sell the house because you're out of the country, something like that. You have the beginning date, end date, and you list the specific purpose.
Could you split power between two people? So let's say you have two kids. In order for your name to be valid, you have to have both their signatures?
Yeah, you put them as co-attorneys, in fact.
Okay.
Yeah. And that is a good backup, you know, to make sure that they're both in agreement. But the problem is that also complicates it. You have to get two signatures anytime you want to get something done. Generally, I recommend don't ever do any more than two because it just becomes a nightmare trying to get that many signatures. Like, I had a client who wanted all seven kids on their trust as co-trustees, and I said, I will not do that because I'm going to be the one having to deal with all seven of those down the road. So I was like, you can pick three. I'll extend it to three. All right, so we did that. So here's your basic estate planning documents that you'll need. First is a living will. That goes along with your healthcare power of attorney. In Nevada, they're two separate documents. In Utah, they're one document. They go together. You have your asset power of attorney. Remember, we want springing power of attorney. Your last will and testament, this is that pour-over will I was mentioning. It says for some reason anything's left out of the trust, everything goes into the trust. And then lastly, we have our living trust. So what are some other estate planning tools? Well, we can do a lot with LLCs or family limited partnerships. That becomes important, especially in estate tax purposes, because we can gift percentages of the business to the kids. And because we're giving such a small percentage, we can gift even more because, you know, the valuation discount. Because if I'm gifting 1%, that's not as much as giving a 51% interest in the business, right? Because they have no voting control and so on. So by giving that 1%, well, now the valuation's down, maybe we can actually gift up to 1.5% to meet that $14,000 value or something like that. So those can be very good, especially if you do it early on. I'm currently reading the autobiography of Sam Walton, and that's one of the things he did is he set up a family limited partnership that owns all of their Walmart stock. And they did that so long ago and gave their kids interest in it that he didn't have to do hardly any gifting and paid almost no estate taxes when he died because he set it up properly. And obviously that was a lot of money because he was worth $165 billion when he died. So, you know, that can be a very advantageous thing. Retirement plans. So I didn't mention this earlier, but if you have, you know, a beneficiary account, life insurance policies, retirement accounts, anything where you can name a beneficiary, those do not go through probate. They only go through probate if all the beneficiaries are deceased. So, you know, you name your spouse and then your kids as the contingent beneficiary, you guys all die, you know, in a plane crash or something like that, then it would go to probate to decide who those life insurance proceeds would go to. But before that, you would not have to have it pass through probate. Annuities, same thing. So, in conclusion, probate and taxes are not the same thing. You need to plan for both. And your plan may differ based on what you're trying to avoid or what you're trying to do. And so that's why you need to have a customized plan. One interesting thing is President Trump has also talked about wanting to eliminate the estate tax, and so that's something to keep on the horizon. If the exemption goes up, if he gets rid of it, what's that gonna look like for your estate planning purposes? Now you focus more on probate and, you know, how your wealth is gonna be distributed versus avoiding the estate taxes. And there are two different types of plans. Plan as early as possible, and especially name the guardian of your minor children. You know, your parents may say that they would take the kids, but, you know, that may not be what you want. But that's usually the default for the courts. If you have parents living, they want to give them to parents first, and then they'll go to siblings. So, you know, if you don't agree with the way your siblings raise their kids and that kind of thing, minor kids are a major reason to do estate planning. And then lastly, live like you were dying.
you know, enjoy your life, spend time with those you love, and actually, you know, enjoy and live like you were dying. Just some new and interesting areas of estate planning that I'm seeing. Post-death birth. So this is the situation. There's been a couple of court cases recently where husband went and froze his sperm, and then he died. Wife was inseminated 6 months later, had the baby at 18 months. Where does that plan come into as far as estate planning purposes? Was that a child of the marriage? Of his, you know, it's his child technically. Does he inherit his estate? And you know, that's, you know, a probate question that becomes very complicated. Adult adoption. So this, it goes along with same-sex marriage. So you'd see where you know, a couple, they you know, same-sex couple, they wanted to because they couldn't do they weren't a spouse, they couldn't get married, and so they, what they do is one would adopt the other so that they would inherit their estate and so on. So really interesting thing. Trust is far more easy, but just something that, you know, I've seen there. And then a new big area is digital assets. You know, your iTunes. Do you own that? No. Apple says you do not. So what happens when you die? That library, the music that you accumulated, is no longer yours and goes back to Apple, and no one has access to it if they find out that you died. Bitcoin. That's an interesting one too. There hasn't really been any case law on that, so we don't know how that's going to play out. PayPal accounts. Technically, it's a bank account, but it's an online access. How does that all work out? We want to list those, and but they won't list it in the name of the trust. So how do we, you know, relegate that there? I think that they're starting to allow you to do pay on death beneficiaries. So you name the trust as the beneficiary on that account. But just a couple of things to think about in new areas about estate planning. So with that, is there any other questions? So it's called an affidavit of small estates. Basically, so you fill out this affidavit. Each state has their own form that they want. So you fill it out. It basically says that I'm the entitled heir, there are no other heirs, and that the estate is worth less than this amount, and so I'll, you know, distribute it to me. And then you sign that under, you know, in witness of a notary, you know, subject to perjury if you are lying. And then they distribute those assets to you.
And it
doesn't go to probate. And it doesn't go to
probate, yep. This is a financial planning class. If we had the full estate planning documents prepared by a good professional attorney, what's mm-hmm. a ballpark range that we should be looking to pay for something like that?
Yeah, I'd say, I don't remember what it price range is here in Utah. In Nevada, you're in the range of $1,500 to about $3,000, depending on experience. And but for a basic estate plan, you should be around $1,500. Here, it's probably closer to $1,000.
That's why you practice in Nevada.
One of the reasons I practice in Nevada, yeah. I get to charge a lot more in Vegas. All right, well, thank you for having me. I have business cards up here. I'll stick around to answer questions at the end.
How about takeaways? Really, and make sure it's the right attorney as well. Other takeaways.
Yeah, just like, I've never thought about this kind of stuff before, but there's a significant amount of wealth that can be taken away through taxes and other things. So planning it out can save your children a lot.
Yeah, planning it out can save your children a lot of money. You know, we're required to pay what's required by law and not a penny more. And the more we can use the legal resources to minimize the amount, the better we are.
You can actually leave your children worse off by not organizing your affairs before you leave.
You can leave your children worse off by not organizing your affairs before you die.
There's just, even after like you die, there's still so much good you can do, like the charitable donations or children and grandchildren. So
take the time to plan, because even after you die, there's a lot you can do to help your children. Let me share a couple of my takeaways. Don't live like you are dying. Die like you are living. Plan for
for it like you were still here. You still can make a difference.
Number two,
know the rules of the game and play it to accomplish what you want. What's the joke? I'm spending my kids' inheritance. I want them to be sad when I die. Number three, Congress gave great conference. Listening to General Conference really gave great guidance for our finances. And the truth is, we can't have the peace the gospel brings if we choose. Thanks, everyone. We will see you on Wednesday.